I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which stands one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to thank everybody for coming tonight on this very cold night. Antoinette, if I could get a roll call vote?
Mr. Burns?
Here.
Mr. Cook?
Here.
Mr. D'Andriano?
Here.
Mr. Rogan?
Here.
Mr. Williams?
Here. We'd like to start off tonight with a presentation by the Economic Development Committee
Corporation,
Jill Verrecchio.
Thank you.
Welcome.
And Jill, if you could use the mic, if you need to move around, if you can take the mic out of the stand.
Alrighty. Honorable members of the town of Patterson, thank you for including me on your agenda tonight. This year is the Putnam County Economic Development Corporation's 20th anniversary. As you know, we postponed our fall recognition dinner till the spring, which you will be invited to. But tonight I'm here to thank each and every one of you for what you have been doing to contribute to the economic vitality of Putnam County. Economic development professionals refer to the region's asset in the terms of the four R's. The four R's, and you might guess, are the rail, the roads, the river, and the nearby runways, and I add for Putnam, rail trails, reservoirs, and remarkable leaders committed to thoughtful economic development that makes a difference. Our history, as some of you might recall, back in 1994, a survey was completed by the Cornell Cooperative and underwritten by the Putnam County Legislature and Planning Department. Their focus was on business development, retention, and our workforce. And their findings resulted in the formation of the Putnam County Economic Development Corporation, a 501c6. As a private public entity, our mission is to be the primary facilitator connecting local resources, opportunities to deliver economic growth. We work to cultivate and expand existing businesses and to promote commercial real estate in order to attract new business. We market the county's assets, such as the proximity to New York City, our Metro North transit links, our infrastructure, and a highly skilled workforce. We advocate for development projects among municipalities and planning boards to ensure the growth of our county's tax base. We educate and assist local nonprofits, small businesses, and municipalities with incentive and grant programs from New York State, utilities, and other funding sources. And we strive for a balanced growth throughout the county to meet the needs of a very broad audience. As some of you know, since my arrival last year, we've been working to identify and build a collaborative group of stakeholders. And my message tonight is a simple one. We want the best for Putnam, and we look forward to carrying out thoughtful economic development together with you guys. So in that, I just have some information. I do have to move, so I'm going to walk over here. I just wanted to give you a certificate.
How can I do all these things together?
And then just as a reminder, because at the end of the day, we like to talk about the positive impact of commercial development. This is a summary statistic coming out of the Real Property Office, the most current 2014
and I do believe his current chief corroborated that it is the most recent. Just some information that in case you're at a cocktail party and you want to chat about it, you do have some information.
Just if you could pick up the mic, because none of this is getting on the camera.
Okay.
So you've got to talk into the mic to get it on the camera.
Okay, well, thank you very much. I hope you enjoy the certificates, the lapel pin, and the message behind my participating here tonight.
Oh, thank you very much for coming in.
Thank you.
I want to say that since you've been with the Economic Development Corporation, it's been wonderful working with you. There's been lot more communication between us and the corporation in trying to bring commercial growth not only to Putnam County but Patterson.
Great.
We received another inquiry today from Jill, looking for a commercial business to come in.
Right. So thank you very much. Yeah, our goal is to find the opportunities, bring them to the table, make certain each municipality is aware of what they might be, because you folks are the ones that really know what's going on, what you would like to have here, and, we try to make the match work.
Question. How many times a year do you meet, do you have
Do I meet with the board?
Yeah.
Okay, the board is comprised of 14 people. They meet every 2 months. In addition to the traditional board format, I've created a committee called the Alliance for Balanced Growth, which that meets once a month, and that's comprised of people who are interested in land use, and that is first Friday of the month at about 9:00 in the morning, and usually get a presentation for 20 minutes, some topics. The next one I'm having will be Light Tower coming in discussing the fiber that's in the county. I've had biochar as a presentation, renewage, different topics of interest, as well as it's an active group to identify how we can then support the activity moving forward. For instance, that bit of information that I just gave to you tonight, we were talking about how we can represent stakeholders in a public forum, and we think that bit of information is very important. So we meet once a month as an active group, that's the Alliance for Balanced Growth, but the formal governance is every 2 months. Anything else? Any other questions? Okay, guys, thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You have the legal notice?
Yes.
Next on the agenda is a public hearing on introductory law number 6, burning permits. Don, if you read the public notice.
Yes. Town of Patterson, notice of hearing, amendments to Chapter 68 of the Patterson Town Code. Public notice is hereby given that there has been introduced before the Town Board of the Town of Patterson, New York on November 30, 2016, an amendment to Patterson Town Code Chapter 68 entitled Burning Permits and Outdoor Fireplaces, which amendment will revise Chapter 68, Article 1 and Article 2 to provide for the suspension of burning permits during times when it may be inappropriate to have open burning. Now, therefore, pursuant to Section 20 of the Municipal Home Rule Law, the Town Board of the Town of Patterson, New York, will hold a public hearing on the aforesaid amendment at the town offices, 1142 Route 311, Patterson, New York, on December 14, 2016, at 7 p.m. in the evening of that day, or as soon thereafter as may be held, at which time all persons interested therein shall be heard. The town board will make every effort to assure that the hearing is accessible to persons with disabilities. Anyone requiring special assistance and or reasonable accommodations should contact the town clerk, dated November 30, 2016, by order of the Patterson, of the town board, sorry, of the town of Patterson, Antoinette Kopeck, town clerk.
So for everyone in the audience, just a quick summary. We are looking to update the section of code that relates to the issuance of burning permits. We've added a definition of chimeneas in there. We have taken out the provision that allows for the burning of leaves. It's not permitted by the DEC anyway. But the primary purpose of all this is we recently became aware this original permit was done when DEC still had some involvement in burning permits. DEC has since stepped back and is given the responsibility to the town for issuing of burning permits. And we realized that absent the DEC suspending burning within the town of Patterson, we had no other way to suspend burning at times when it might not be appropriate. So we are adding a clause so that the town board or the town supervisor can suspend burning and burning permits within the town. Does anybody have any questions or comments on the local law? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
Motion to close the public hearing.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, can I get a motion on the reports?
I'll make a motion to approve the code compliance report from November, the code enforcement report from November, the dog control officer report from November, the environmental conservation or ECI from, there was none actually to approve. Patterson Recreation had none. Patterson Fire Department did submit their third quarter report of 2016, and Putnam Lake has submitted their third quarter report. So I'll make a motion to approve those reports as submitted. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
And there's no supervisor's minutes?
There is no supervisor's report. We're up to date, though. Can I get a motion on the minutes?
I'll make a motion to approve the public hearing minutes of the preliminary budget continued to October 26, 2016. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Can I get someone to audit the bills?
I'll make a motion to town board approve abstract number 22, dated December 2nd, 2016. In the amount of $629,941.56. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Mr. Burns.
All right. First item on my agenda is a request from Russ. I would like to request to hire a per diem to fill in for Margo when she takes time off. This person will cover phones and do light secretarial duty in Margo's absence. I request to hire Samantha Goff at a rate of $14 as per town policy. She worked at the highway department before in 2004 for the summer, so she is familiar with the job. So I'll make a motion to approve that request. Are we doing it for discussion or just to approve it?
Well,
I'll make a motion to approve the hiring of Samantha Goff at $14 an hour. So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Next item on the agenda, budget transfer requests. We have two. Budget transfer request 52 is to move $6,600 between Recreation Center, Light and Power to $6,600 to Recreation Contractual. And budget transfer request 53 is to move monies within various lines, justice services, town clerk, planner, state retirement, social security, hospital, ambulance, contractual, to ambulance equipment and capital outlay for some total sum of $156,000. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All right, last item on my agenda, we having had a public hearing on the amendment of Patterson Toad Chapter 68 titled Burning Permits and Outdoor Fireplaces, which was introduced today. I have a resolution approving the adoption of Local Law Number 6 of 2016. So since we've just heard what the rule was about, we discussed it last time, I'll just move the resolution as read. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Mr. D'Andrea.
First item on my agenda, recreation request. I don't have any recreation requests. I just have a letter from the rec department. Is that a typo?
It was a request to read a letter.
Okay.
Right.
So we have a very nice letter from Veronica Roach, a rec leader down at the rec center, in regards to Breakfast with Santa. Last Saturday, December 10th, the rec center hosted its annual Breakfast with Santa. This event has become a Patterson tradition. This year, we served well over 150 children and adults from our community and collected two boxes of non-perishable food items for a local food pantry. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank everyone who played a part in making this day run so smoothly. It was the combined efforts of all involved that ensured our success. Our recreation assistants worked importantly before, during, and after the program. On Friday night, they worked tirelessly, transforming our rec room into Santa's workshop. On Saturday, they worked serving endless stacks of pancakes and sausages to the hungry crowd. And when all was said and done, they left our facility so spotless one would never know that the event ever happened. Many thanks to our staff, including Marcus, Teddy, Jason, Megan, I'm not even gonna mention their last names, I'm gonna destroy them, Matt, Aaron, Skylar, Sierra, CJ, and Sean. Your effort and enthusiasm is appreciated. I would like to give a big shout out to Cole Doherty, who has volunteered at this event for the past 5 years and has become a part of the REC family. Thanks also to those from Patterson Town Hall, both past and present, who once again volunteered their time and talent in our kitchen. Your support for this event year after year is invaluable, and your presence has become part of the Breakfast with Santa tradition. Much gratitude to current Town Supervisor Rich Williams, former Town Supervisor Mike Griffin, Linda Griffin, Sue Brown, and Town Councilman Sean Rogan. We also would like to thank our friends from the Patterson Library for lending their creativity to our craft area. Ms. Jen and Ms. Catherine have been working with our multi-activity camps throughout the summer and also support our Family Fun Day. This is the first time they have participated in Breakfast with Santa, and it was great to have them. Another welcome addition this year was our friends from Playwell Technologies. They run the Lego programs offered at the rec center during the summer and for the first time over the upcoming holiday vacation. And finally, a special thanks to you, Mr. and Mrs. Santa Claus, also known as Ed and Marianne O'Connor. Patterson Recreation was one of their limited engagements this season, and we wouldn't have had it any other way. Their patience, enthusiasm, and dedication make it impossible not to catch the holiday spirit. Thank you to Recreation Director Matt Chabarro for helping to make this day one of Patterson Recreation's finest. The encouragement and motivation he has offered was exactly what fueled the event to be enjoyed by participants and employees alike. I know it's a lengthy letter, but I think it was well written, and it included everybody that worked very hard on a special day. So
we certainly also want to include, even though she wrote the letter, that Veronica Roche, that was her first year as rec leader running the event. She did a fantastic job.
Absolutely fantastic job.
It was very well done.
Kudos to all.
Next item on my agenda is the recycling special permit fees. We worked on this with Russ Goff and Margot, myself, Sean. It's been kicked around a couple times, chewed out. I think we've all had it. Anybody have anything they want to add or comment on?
I'll make one comment that kind of got kicked around was the went from the other category to the miscellaneous category now, and the cost is on here is $20. My thought is that if the miscellaneous is a item that's bigger than all the rest of these, maybe the cost should be higher. I don't know. It's
are we measuring this before it's compacted or after it's compacted? Because I mean, I think of like a cubic yard is 3 foot by 3 foot by 3 foot. That 1.5 cubic feet is
about not 4 by 4 by 4, roughly.
How is a cubic? Is 4 by 4 feet? Is that? I don't think so. A cubic foot is 1 foot by 1 foot by 1 foot.
A cubic yard.
If you're saying 1.5 cubic yards,
yeah,
this is 1.5 cubic
yards,
feet.
Yeah, it's using feet, not yards, Rich. It's not cubic yards.
Cubic feet.
Oh, that's supposed to be cubic yards.
That's what I was wondering.
I'm sorry, I didn't pick that
up. All right.
Okay.
So the intent is for that to be 1.5 cubic yards?
Right? It was supposed to be yards.
Yeah. Okay. So it's just a typo.
Okay. All right. That's all fine. Right.
Yeah, I think that we did struggle with that one particular thing. How do you, you know, that was, you know, you kind of try to include, you don't want to, you know, it's impossible to include every single item there is. And then to kind of throw in miscellaneous, how do you measure that? You know, we talked about weight. Weighing it, but you know, how do you weigh it? Well, you know, we have the ability to, you know, scale, you know, a pickup truck's worth, or you know, well, you know, it's just, you know, so we kind of kicked that around a little bit, but
certainly there
thinking,
was.
Go ahead. That, you know, if we charged $30 for a refrigerator and $40 for a sectional couch, and those two items, I guess, jump out. Maybe we should charge $50 if it's. Stuff's coming in. Maybe there was one mention of piano one time or something.
That was the one that triggered this, I think, last week. Is somebody tried to drop a piano off.
I have some concerns only because I walk my dogs down Couch Road, and there's a reason that Couch Road is called Couch Road. Because what happens is when you go to the recycling center and people find out that it's $20 to throw out a sectional, it gets dumped over the side at Couch Road. And I've seen couches, there's a car seat, if anybody has a Chrysler van and needs a back seat, there's a back seat down there. There were about 15 propane tanks that were down there. So, you know, while it's great to say we're going to raise all these funds, it may dissuade people from putting garbage where garbage should be. So I applaud Russ in terms of we'd like to make this not a drain on the, you know, a profit center, so to speak. I think you're going to see, you may see some increased activity of people just dumping things places. Like I've seen it on 164. Anybody who's driven through the railroad bridges, I've seen couches just abandoned. You know, people just stop and drop it because they don't want to. So I'm not opposed to putting it in place, but I think we should be really willing to revisit this if we see an increase of people just dumping in the town.
And I think, you know, before we do that, most people that I've talked to don't have a problem with the additional charges. They're very happy to pay the additional charges just to get rid of the items. Mm-hmm. The problem we have, and it's one that we really need to work on this year, I need to work on this year, is that it's sometimes difficult for people to get here, get the permits, so they can bring the items in. They show up, they're not aware that they need the permits, so then they, you know, dump it on the side of the road.
Right.
We need to make it easier to get the permits.
And Kevin, to your point, I couldn't agree more. A focal point of our discussion when we met with Russ was the balance between creating revenue and turning people off and having them go down the back road and make it easier to drop it off and do something illegal. So actually the prices listed here have come down from what was initially proposed. Okay. Because I agree exactly with what you said, that you know, we wanted to make it easy. Flip side is, as you know, when we went through the analysis, and I see Phil back there, when we went through our analysis for sanitation, one of the difficulties was trying to at least try to offset or maintain some of these costs to be able to keep our town employees employed. And so I support these changes that Russ worked so hard on, but I agree with your statement. And I think we need to be continually aware of whether or not this becomes a problem, because we're going to pay for it then anyway. The guys are going to have to go down Couch Road and pick
it
up.
Yeah, for free.
I think the prices were pretty comparable to the other towns, or even a little cheaper in some cases, right?
Yeah.
So we want to leave the miscellaneous at 20?
Yeah, other than changing that one typo.
And then we'll see how it goes. If we need to adjust it going down the road, I guess we can adjust it.
So are we good with this?
Just out of curiosity, we are actually talking about, like, what if someone has a 1.5-yard cubic container that they filled with junk and just want to have us pick up? Will we take that for $20? Like, what if someone gets a garbage container
and free bulk pickup?
Yeah, like, yeah. So they would do that. Okay. Right.
Yeah.
The miscellaneous really is for unusual items such as the piano.
Okay.
So I'd like to make a motion to accept these fees.
Second.
And approve the form for use.
With the exception of the typo.
With the exception.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, second item on my, last item on my agenda, award bids for town ambulance. We did get the bid. We got one bid in, I believe.
We received one bid.
We received one bid from Specialty Vehicles for the total price of $137,930. I believe this was even lower, a little lower than we anticipated, which turned out good. They met all our specs that we asked for, everything we needed, including marking the vehicle and everything else that we really wanted. So we do have resolution here. So I guess we need a discussion on how we want to go forward with this. Or?
Well, we transferred the money earlier, right?
We've already transferred the money. Yeah. The money's there. We already have the money in this year's budget. We've been able to find it in different accounts. So
we're in good shape
to start this up if that's the direction everybody wants to go.
Well, I have a question as to whether we're putting the cart before the horse or if this is the right way to proceed. If we are going to hire an EMS, you know, ambulance coordinator, do we want to hire that person and then at least give them some input, or is the ambulance really non-issue?
I think for the most part, the ambulance would be a non-issue for the EMS coordinator. We're going to hand them the ambulance. We're going to hand them the program. We're going to hand them the billing company, and they're just going to run it for us.
So you don't think that they would have any value additive input?
I think through the EMS committee that we've had a lot of good input from a lot of very qualified people. So, and we've all worked on this, developing this, Dave Raines in particular. So I think we're in good shape with the specs and the type of ambulance that we're looking for. We looked at a number of different models out here in the parking lot. So, no, I think this is the ambulance that is going to serve us best, at least for the immediate future. At some point, we're going to have to go down the road of looking at a second ambulance, but for now.
So we do have a resolution to award the bid to Specialty Vehicles Incorporated for the total bid of one price of $137,903. I'd like to make a motion to accept the resolution as written.
So moved. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Also, to go along with the ambulance, it wouldn't really serve us much purpose if we didn't have a stretcher and stair chair. So we do have a resolution here as well. Purchase a Striker stretcher for $17,964.54. It seems an excessive price, but for both pieces of equipment, for this type of stretcher and this type of stair chair working in the EMS field, these stretchers, that's a hydraulic type stretcher, the stair chair pretty much has tracks to help roll down a set of stairs, and it's a real back saver, and it reduces injuries. So even though the price may seem high, I think in the long run, spending money on good equipment will prevent injuries, specifically back injuries and other injuries, and probably save us money in workers' comp fees and so on down the road. So
one of the largest issues we're going to face is with the workers' comp and the increases on that, because EMS workers are typically subject to a lot of back injuries. So that's why we chose to go with a stretcher that was going to try to reduce or minimize whatever back injuries there may be.
So we do have a resolution here. I'd like to make a motion to... Did you have something?
Just a quick comment. The resolution that was drafted and sent refers to the stretcher, but not to the chair. It's a separate item, correct?
No, it's not. Same item.
Same item. Okay, great.
I believe it's a package deal. We got a cheaper price to buy them together.
Two separate items of equipment. This refers only to the stretcher. Or is that part of the stretcher?
I guess it would be the stretcher package.
It was a stretcher package.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, it was one price, one bid.
So if you, the price is right, but it's described as stretcher.
Just a stretcher.
Reference the attached quote.
Insert, a stretcher package. Stair chair.
The prayer.
Yeah, I have.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
So you might want to call it the stretcher package in the resolution.
Okay. So we're going to amend the resolution to say stretcher
package. Yeah, to include the stair chair.
As described in the proposal, sure. Which is in the
right. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
And that is all I have.
Okay. Just so everybody's aware, we've got a couple of other topics we need to talk about with the ambulance, but we'll save it to the end. Okay?
The next topic on the agenda is the Burdick subdivision application and recommendation from the Planning Board.
Mr. Supervisor, on this next application, I'm going to recuse myself. The application is for my wife's family, so I'm going to leave the room and leave you gentlemen to your deliberations.
Thank you. We do have the engineer who is representing the applicant here tonight. Jack, you want to run us through what you're proposing to do?
The Burdick zone, approximately 12 acres.
Take the mic.
Yeah, take the mic, Jack.
You know how it works at the planning board meetings?
I forget.
Same thing.
John Carell, I'm the engineer for the Burdicks. They own a 12-acre piece of property on McManus Road north,
south.
No, south. They propose to, there's an existing house on the north side. They propose to cut it into two properties. One is 7 acres with the house. And the other is 5 acres, at which they're intent to convey to somebody and to build a house, a separate house. The problem is, according to the town records, the town road only goes up partially in front of the frontage, about 100 and some odd feet. And the requirement is that there be 225 feet on an improved town road. So we're here for a variance under Section 280A. to grant an open development approval for this property so that it can be subdivided without improving the road for another 100 feet.
So the real issue with this application is the fact that they are providing access off of an easement, which under town law section 288, as Jack alluded to, requires the town to approve an open development area to move forward with this. And that is the mechanism by which either the town board or really, or appropriately, the planning board can impose what conditions they need to ensure that the access provided is adequate for emergency services, fire protection services, and is properly maintained. I believe the board has two different ways we can proceed with this application. I think based on the number of people who are currently using that easement, that we would, it would be appropriate that there be some sort of maintenance agreement established for all the lots that are fronting, so that everybody shares in you know, proportionately to the maintenance of that right of way going back. We can either approve the 280A and allow them to go back to the planning board, and the planning board with the town attorney can wrestle with the issue of the maintenance agreement, or we can wait and review a maintenance agreement, and if it's satisfactory to the town board, then we can approve the 280A. Does anyone have a preference?
I'd say the former. Send it to the planning board to grapple with the maintenance agreement.
Okay. Yeah.
Fine with that.
Somebody want to make a motion?
Oh, I'll make a motion that the town board.
Go ahead, make the motion. Maybe we get this. Just for my own curiosity, how many lots are served, Jack, by that?
This would be the fourth home.
This would be the fourth. Just to anticipate having this thing move forward, is it anticipated that all of the homeowners would agree to enter into a maintenance agreement?
I would think so, because most of them are Burdicks.
Okay. That helps.
They're all family.
Okay. They can discuss it over a Christmas dinner.
So, but if we make a motion to approve the 280A,
yes,
subject to the planning board establishing proper maintenance for the access easement, do you like that?
Mm-hmm. Right. I don't think you need to come back to your board to approve the form of the maintenance agreement. You can resolve to establish the open development area.
And if then the property owners do not agree to establish that,
then there is no
subdivision.
Correct. Sounds good. Just wanted to see what was coming down the pike that was sent out.
Okay. So I will make the motion that the town board authorize the planning board to...
Would you like some help?
Interference. The town board approves the variance according to 280A.
It's not really a variance.
Establish an open development area.
Correct.
There's an alternative procedure in section 280A for a variance, but it does not apply to this scenario. So the technical act that the board will be doing is establishing an open development area for that subdivision.
Okay. It's not what it says here in our letter, but that's all right. Help.
Yes, the town board would like to approve the establishment of an open development area pursuant to town law section 280A subsection 4 and refer the matter back to the planning board with the provision that a maintenance agreement between all the property owners sharing the use of the access easement participate in a maintenance agreement proportionately to their frontage on the easement.
Informed satisfactory to the planning board and town attorneys.
You always got to get in there.
Planning board.
In a form sufficient to the planning board and town attorney.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
You're heading back.
All right, I'll go tag Sean in. I'm going to be recused for the next one. So
okay.
Okay.
Thank you. get yourself plenty of shovels and salt for the winter.
What did you volunteer me for?
Nothing. We'll tell you later.
All right.
We'll find out over Christmas dinner.
Are you with the devil?
I've done a lot of that.
All right, moving right along.
Okay, next we have the appointment of a town justice, and we have a short resolution here. So, whereas a vacancy now exists in the position of the Patterson Town Justice due to the unfortunate passing of the Honorable John E. King prior to the expiration of his term, and whereas the Town Board of the Town of Patterson, pursuant to Town Law 64.5, is authorized to fill the vacancy by appointment of a Town Justice until the next general election and until his or her successor is duly elected and qualified. And whereas the Town Board of the Town of Patterson has accepted applications and interviewed qualified candidates to serve as Town Justice to fill such vacancy, and whereas the Town Board has determined that Michael Caruso has exhibited the experiences, qualifications, and other attributes necessary to serve as Town Justice, now therefore be it resolved that the Town Board of the Town of Patterson hereby appoints Michael Caruso to serve as Town Justice until such time as the Town Justice is elected to fill the unexpired term of the Honorable John E. King and until his or her successor is duly elected and qualified. Be it further resolved that the Town Supervisor is hereby authorized and directed to take all necessary action to give effect to this resolution. So moved.
Doc. Just a clarification, and then now therefore, until such time, it really should read temporary town justice.
I took the word temporary out.
Okay.
Just so you know.
Okay. To fill the unexpired term. So it's not, we don't need until such time as a town justice is elected. Because the unexpired term will have expired by that time. So now therefore should read,
okay.
Town Justice, to serve as Town Justice to fill the unexpired term and until his successor is duly elected and qualified. Right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Great.
Okay. Can I get a second?
Second.
I just want to let everybody know that the Town Board has wrestled with this quite a bit. We interviewed three different candidates for the position of judge. Our own Kevin Burns was one of those applicants. I think the town would have been very well served by any one of the applicants that we did interview. However, this one gentleman exhibited a more well-rounded understanding and it had shown a great deal of experience in dealing with all the various aspects of law that the judge is going to have to deal with, and he had a good deal of familiarity with the operation of the Patterson Court. So it was generally our opinion that this one gentleman is going to hit the ground running. He's going to be able to step into this very quickly, very easily, and we needed to get somebody in there very quickly because Anthony Mollet, our current judge, who's been doing an outstanding job, is essentially been sitting over there by himself handling all these cases for the past year. So we wanted somebody that was going to be able to step in and move very quickly to get up to speed. So anybody else have any comments?
Also, Mr. Caruso seemed to be the most flexible in terms of being able to leave his practice at a moment's notice and
for various arraignments and
correct,
other court
correct. And I know that was one thing that was very valuable as well.
Correct. So. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Can you bring Kevin back in?
Our new town judge. Do I get to know now?
Do you want to know now?
Well, sure. I mean, okay. I'd like to know.
Okay. The motion was made, seconded, and approved to appoint Michael Caruso as Patterson Town Justice.
Sounds good.
All right. Okay. Charlie, do you want to talk about mileage logs or?
Activity reports.
Activity reports.
I guess is this, this is the one where certain folks are not providing this activity, certain town employees are not providing this information to the supervisor's office.
Right. Back in 2009, the town board established a policy whereby everybody needs to submit activity and mileage logs. And second page shows the activity logs, the mileage logs, and the way they were supposed to be filled out. I could tell you that we have one person out of the several who have to fill these out who are doing it correctly. Most of the people are not putting the time in, time out. For whatever reason, they find it too burdensome. The other problem I have with this is they're not submitting a monthly, so that we're going to change that. They're going to have to start catching up and submitting a monthly. But my question to the board while we're discussing this is, you know, are you comfortable with this activity log? Do you want this filled out? I will tell you the next page, the third page, is one that I did that I used when I was working here as town planner, because I always felt it was appropriate to have the beginning and ending mileage. And that was more important to me than some of the other information on our current form, especially if we're talking about people filling these out who are using their personal vehicles.
We certainly get every month vouchers to reimburse people for the use of their car, which we are grateful for. But yeah, I mean, if the employees are to fill out these documents, they should do it. And I guess, are you looking for support?
Well, I'm looking for your opinion about, for example, do they need to fill in the time in, time out, which most people are not.
Do the employees fill out timesheets for the day? I don't know whether it's different between technical and clerical folks in terms of what programs they work in and where they spend their time each day.
No, they will fill out a timesheet that says, this is what time I started, this is what time I took lunch, this is what time I ended for the day.
So
the only person that ever kept a timesheet that had to account for all his time was me.
So are these non-exempt or exempt employees?
These are
Hourly or not, you know, hourly or salaried?
They're both.
Because, I mean, it would seem to me, I don't really care what time they come get there unless they leave, unless they're hourly employees. If they're salaried employees, I just need to know that they went there and, you know, they clocked in at 8, they come back here at 5.
Yeah.
I'm not so concerned about.
There is some merit to knowing the hours that they clock in, clock out for even salaried employees, because there's always the issue of, them trying to recapture some of the time that they worked over, carrying it over to other pay periods.
Flex time.
So.
Well, let me ask Sean a question. Sean, at the county? Oh, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Are you done?
Yeah, go ahead.
I didn't mean to interrupt. You go out frequently, mm-hmm. every day. Do you do this? Do you say you left the office at 9 o'clock and returned at 10 o'clock?
We do, and we have to say every site that we're going to, every location with the time in, time out, or time expected back, and then sign in, sign out. Yeah. For all hours. And then on our timesheets, we have to list every, because for us, a lot of it's reimbursable time. So we have to list the various programs that we worked in, the time associated, almost like job chargeable with, that would be more appropriate for like the attorneys. Mm-hmm. So that the time spent goes to the appropriate program, because different programs have different reimbursement rates. So there is quite a bit of timekeeping in that regard.
Again, that's why when I was town planner, I had to do the same thing. I had to keep track of every minute I worked throughout the day. Some of it was billable.
But I'm not necessarily saying that I think we need to go to a more stringent system. I think that you gain respect from employees by treating them with respect. I think all this is looking to do is to codify and make sure that we're getting accurate mileage reimbursement, right? And where people are going when they're using.
Right.
So I think they're kind of a little bit two separate conversations here.
Yeah, I mean, to have them document the time, I'm not sure if that's all necessary. Certainly, they're going out and going to put in for mileage from town hall to wherever, and why they went and how many miles, and what's TV and PV mean?
Personal vehicle town vehicle.
Oh. Okay.
And yeah, no, I mean, my opinion on this is I don't think we need the time in, time out. And I think there, you know, most people are finding it a little burdensome to constantly, you know, check that. We are going to, you know, personal iPads, so they'll have this electronically, so it's not going to be that difficult to fill out. But I would like to see, at least for the personal vehicles, we add a line for beginning and ending mileage.
Sure.
So.
So just your odometer reading on your...
Yeah.
Real simple.
So this form we're not using at the current time, correct?
No.
Is this what we're looking at?
No, that was my form, which Trish yelled at me every week for, but...
This shows more of the mileage, their mileage.
Yeah, I just wanted to show everybody what I was doing.
Real simple.
I think something like that, yeah. I think it's nice and simple.
Yeah. So I can revise the form, work with Trish, who did the original, and bring it back to you for the next meeting.
That's great.
Yeah.
All right.
So you're going to eliminate the time out, time in, and you're going to add with a little mileage.
Yep.
How do we do it?
Can I comment the mic or not? Is there what? Not in the... Sure. Be careful.
Of course be careful.
You know the rules.
Okay. Dave Raines, Fire Inspector. One of my observations over the 20-plus years is that two things need to happen. I think we need to roll it out to all the managers to make sure it's across the board. And I think that's one of, I don't want to call it a failure, but one of the shortcomings of the system.
Yeah.
And the other thing is that for those of us that work hourly and not every day, we should probably make, in whatever policy you adopt, make it a daily. Because I know where I get boogered up is that two Fridays from now, or a Saturday or a Sunday, whenever I do my time for the 2 week prior, that's when I'm like, oh, was it Thursday? And did I do 28 miles? I don't put in mileage anymore, but that's my own personal thing. But I'm also thinking that for 2017, we might want to capture my personal miles, even if I'm not putting it in for reimbursement. Because when somebody comes up and says, hey, we need a new car for the building department, we're not really capturing my couple thousand miles that I may use. Mm-hmm. We might just look at Lou's and Bob's, and then we're losing maybe a third of what the total miles that the department's doing.
It's a very good point.
And the only reason I don't put in miles is because I'll go on a fire call that really isn't the town's, and then, you know, be off the clock, on the clock, and it gets boogered up. So,
well, it's very similar to the conversation of people accounting for their hours, even if they work overtime, let's say through lunch or extra, but they're not putting in for pay for it, but it's what it takes to get the job done. Without accounting for that time, you're underselling your program. Right. You're not accounting. You're saying, well, we're thinking you can get this job done with one full-time person, right, when really it takes somebody full-time who's really dedicated, like when you used to work 8 days a week as planner.
Right.
You know,
other point is that with Municity now that we're really getting a point where we're using it the right way, and it's going to be able to generate a daily, a weekly, or a monthly, which I figured out how to do, which is really great. What the categories I've added now is that when I'm doing like plan review or office support, it's going into Municity now. So I may not do a fire inspection for 3 days, but I may be in the office covering, I may be doing plan review, I may be doing, I was just at Plaza Clover Lake for 4 hours.
Right.
Because we had a carbon monoxide situation there. And that stuff would not normally be captured, time in, time out. You'd see that I worked 7 hours today or 5 hours today, but you wouldn't really. So one of the things as you develop this policy, make it a daily and make sure the categories are captured. Just again, I think it'll help, you know, when we look at budgets and we look at staffing and we look at, you know. And that goes, too, even for Leslie's support. What did Leslie do? Did she do violations? Did she do something else, and then we can really look at that on a regular basis. Just my two cents.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay, Mr. Rogan, you're up to bat.
Okay. The first item we have, probably got them all out of order here now, was a recommendation from the planning board in reference to a site plan for 859 Fair Street Realty LLC to establish a performance bond with associated inspection fees. So on recommendation of the planning board, I will make a motion that the town board approve setting a performance bond for $22,000 with the associated inspection fees in the amount of $8,100.
We're doing the resolution that's been prepared, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
So I will introduce this resolution as though it were read in its entirety into the record. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. The next item.
How did I get that
so messed up? Thank you. I messed up my order here. We had hired a wonderful young man into the sanitation department, Tyler, 6 or 8 months ago, and Ruskoff had basically put him on probationary period, a 6-month probationary period. That time has since passed. We have a glowing recommendation from Russ to now move him along in his wages and, in essence, promote him to the position that we hired him for, which is a mechanic, at a rate of $31.42 per hour, and the effective date would be December 1st. So I'll move that we take that action. So moved.
I second that.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye. Thank you for that. And the last item is simply an authorization to update the local highway inventory. And this is done where the New York State Department of Transportation keeps inventories on our lengths of town roads for maintenance purposes. Ruskoff and his staff have taken a look at those routes and mileages and made the necessary corrections to basically length of roadway and the amount of miles of roads that are maintained by our town employees. So I will move to introduce the resolution that we have before us with the attached Schedule A documents, which list the various roadways and the changes that were made. I will introduce the resolution as though it were read in its entirety into the record with the inclusion of Schedule A. So moved.
Second.
And for discussion, just so everybody is aware, Schedule A is not the whole thing.
Okay.
It is just the one little sheet that shows the changes.
The changes. Okay.
Correct.
Great.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
That is it. Okay. First on my agenda tonight is we're going back once more to the volunteer release and waiver forms that our volunteers, we've asked our volunteers to sign so that the town is not extending its liability out farther than we would hope to. And the Putnam Lake Park Advisory Board has raised some issues. And Pat, would you like to address any of those other than the memo that you wrote and sent in? You had a number of questions for me.
Well,
with the town attorney.
Yes.
You broke the mic.
Sorry. Okay. Pat Ploger, town of Patterson, Putnam Lake Park Board. I don't know if everyone should be made aware of this or you don't care if it's, you know, I mean, you guys are deciding on this, but I've said pretty much everything in the memo here. We've been pretty much saying it verbally for the past year and a half. The problem is that while we are appointees, and as unpaid appointees, I guess are categorized as volunteers, we are also subject to a lot of the requirements that employees are, including taking the annual online courses for violence and sexual harassment prevention. We go through security clearances, and we perform a great deal of work for the tax district, for the taxpayers of the district, that make things possible there. Otherwise, we would be way far behind where we are now. I mean, we have so much work on our plate to do. And our problem is, as we've stated many times, since we are all covered by our own medical insurance policies, we have no problem waiving any medical liability should we become injured. However, the property damage clause is bothering, and whatever, here's the thing, other than the fact that we don't get paid, because this was a promise that the town made to the community that because of all the years of unpaid volunteerism that the Putnam Lake Community Council put in, it would be a slap in the face to suddenly appoint a board and then pay them. So we willingly have foregone, that's the correct tense, being paid. We also do not submit for mileage. We pay up front for those things that the town doesn't have a credit card for or an account for. If it's something we have to pay tax, obviously, we eat the tax because the town won't reimburse us for that. And we have no complaints about these things, believe me. But then, other than the fact that we don't get paid, we are employees. And I jokingly say, I thought I retired and now I have a new full-time job. But I think that goes to, Sean, you know, from chairing the planning board, suddenly those become, you know, full-time jobs. But we put ourselves in a similar position, and I would say sometimes even more, than Mr. Doyle, our maintenance man, or Mr. Mays, the town's maintenance man who comes and helps us on a as-needed basis, for which we pay, obviously. But whatever they're covered for, whether it's their damage to their personal vehicles, a loss of tools, damage they inflict on somebody else or somebody else's property, we want to be assured that we have that same coverage. You know, this is fine if you're this particular waiver, if you're going out and you're working for a day at Habitat for Humanity. That's not what we're doing. You know, we're not just doing a casual, let's do a good deed and volunteer. And we really feel that some accommodation needs to be made to protect us. And we understand the town needs to be protected, obviously. And as Rich has very often said, but we are the town. The park district is part of the town. So we are protecting not only the town in a whole, but we're also protecting the park district. But in return, we're giving so much of ourselves in terms of manual labor, technical expertise. We have, for example, one of our jobs right now is we have probably 24 boats that people have left on the parkland, and they're there for 2 weeks now, and they have to be removed. So who removes them? Well, you need a good-sized truck, number one. You need a couple strong guys, number two. And this is what we will be doing this weekend. So I just don't know how else to put it. And I know we seem like the bad guys because we've said we can't sign it. It's not that we can't sign it. Nobody has said to us how we will be protected. We will be protected if anything should happen to us while we are in the course of performing our work for the town and for the park district per se. Do you have any questions for me?
I don't have questions at this point, Pat, but I think I'd like to talk a little bit more about it because, frankly, this, I've really looked at kind of two sets of volunteers. It's really two different types. There's the appointees to the board who are regularly there. This form also addresses those who volunteer to come out on a Saturday for weed cleanup or something like that. So that, and really, this is the first time I've heard it verbalized, that it's the board members themselves. neighbors that are expressing concern about this, because it's a different category and might potentially be looked at differently. So we will discuss that. I will discuss it with Rich. But the concept behind the release that's been prepared is that the town doesn't really monitor who volunteers are that come for your board. They're not aware of who it might be. Someone might call you and say, I'm free Saturday morning, I'll come down and mm-hmm. cut weeds, for want of a better example. The town has a difficult position if it's going to say it's going to treat injuries, damages that someone like that might in fact cause. That's extending potential liability beyond where the town might want to be. Okay.
Correct.
The release as drafted releases the town and its agents and employees from all but gross negligence and intentional acts. So there's not a complete waiver of claims against the town. Okay. Also, there's no question that volunteers are covered under the town's liability coverage, so that's in place. There's nothing in the form that's been used to date that in any way limits that. But I will, review it again and with a mind to, if there's some way to treat appointed members of the board differently than ad hoc volunteers, mm-hmm. I'll take a look at it.
What you just said about the liability, you're saying that they are covered under the town's liability for acts of negligence they may commit? Is that what you're suggesting?
Yes.
Okay.
The board is.
No, I think any board.
But the releases act to purport to release the town from any liability.
Or injury to the volunteer.
To the volunteer.
Maybe I missed the boat, but I never contemplated this was going to be signed by a board member. I thought this was going to be signed by the people who come and volunteer. This is the first time I'm hearing that we ever contemplated having a board member sign this.
Well, Kevin, we've been under the opposite impression, because we were told, as a matter of fact, have a note saying, please have the board members sign this. No one ever said to us, oh, by the way, when you're out there carrying all those pieces of vines and brush and everything that you've cut down with your chainsaw up to the road so it can be picked up and chopped up and hauled away. Nobody ever said, oh, by the way, those people, if they're not board members, have got to sign this waiver. I was under the impression that this waiver was for our board members.
What you're saying, though, basically would have town-wide application, not just for your
correct.
For your board.
It and would every,
have it for
every,
others.
Sure.
And
it would, every board member has signed it. The problem we have here is pretty much every board that we have is performing either a supervisory or administrative function.
I haven't signed it. Has anyone on this board signed it?
You're an elected official. You're in a different category altogether.
Yeah, and you're also paid, so you're covered with, assuming, workers' compensation and other good things.
Planning board has signed it, ZBA has signed it, am I correct?
Right.
Okay.
I'm sorry, Rick.
Anyway, the problem we have is the people in Putnam Lake and the Park Advisory Board goes above and beyond all the time in what's typically expected an advisory board to do.
Correct.
So, and that's the conundrum that we're stuck with here.
Okay, I have to admit, like Kevin, our office has been looking at it for the ad hoc person who decides that they're
right.
So who decided to give it to the planning board? Because that was never my contemplation to give it to the planning board to sign.
Yeah.
We'll have to go back and take a look, but this has been from day one. This is way before my tenure on this board.
I'm just saying, I understand.
The Veterans Park, they've signed it. I'm fairly certain they've all signed it. The people at the rec center, they've all signed it.
Well, they probably have fairly innocuous jobs compared to what you're doing out. Yeah,
but nonetheless,
I don't have to go and work out on, during that.
No, but it's just a matter of degree then, Pat, because a member of the planning board who goes on a site walk might could conceivably have the same issue and concern. So mm-hmm. let's give us a little more time to take a look at it again, and with that in mind, see what else you might suggest.
All right, the ball is back in your park then.
I have a question totally unrelated to the waiver. You said you'd be collecting the boats. Those are boats that people didn't properly remove when they were supposed to?
Correct, December 1st.
What do you do with them when you remove
them? Okay, we take them, we load them on, and we store them in the boathouse. This is one of the jobs. One of our board will go around probably on Sunday, if not before, and I may be doing that tomorrow. Weather permitting, I will be going around making a note of all those boats that are tagged that do have current registration stickers on them, and they are numbered, and we have a database, the town clerk, and we have a database, so that we will contact these people if we have their contact info and say, your boat is there, please remove it, or it will be impounded, and you'll have to pay $75 to ransom it. If we can't, there are some boats that have been on the parkland that we can't move. There's a great big flat-bottomed, whatever kind of a boat, fish, one of those fishing boat things that's really heavy, and it has a chain this thick that we've got to get a band saw or something to. I mean, this is serious work we do. I'm not doing that part of it, not that serious. I'm a landscaping person. We have to cut the chains, haul them over to the boathouse, store them over the winter, and if they're not ransomed by, over the winter, then we put them up for sale with, Antoinette sends out, I think, a 30-day notice, Antoinette? Yes, 30-day notice in the spring, saying that we're going to have an auction on April whatever, and... that's it. So sometimes we raise money from it, so it pays for itself in a sense, but it's a lot of work and hard work.
Thank you.
Anything else? I'm sorry to take so much of your time.
No, thank you for explanation on that.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. Back to the more important stuff here. Next on my agenda is from time to time people will end up being hurt on the job, going out on workers' comp. When the injury has been cured, they are ready to return to work. Always in the past, the policy has been to pretty much take whatever hand-scribbled note the doctor is willing to offer. I'm not so comfortable with doing that, is accepting a return to work from the doctor. I mean, some of the notes were barely legible. So I asked Sue Brown to work up a form, which she has very kindly done. And everybody who is returning to work would be required to fill this form out. I think we've just used it once recently. It seems to be working okay. But I wanted to bring it before the board to get your opinion, your comments, any thoughts.
Does this come back down to liability for allowing somebody back to work that maybe doesn't? I mean, has there been an issue in the past where an employee has come back to work and then re-injured because they weren't ready to come back? Or?
I'm not sure that that's ever occurred. I'm looking for more information rather than some doctors scribbling on the back of a notepad saying, yeah, he's ready to come back to work, and not having a lot of detail accompanying that.
No, I think it's a good idea to have the form, and we did take a look at it and went back and forth over the extent of the information that was requested, but I think it's better to err on the side of completeness, and we tossed around whether the requested information might violate provisions of the American with Disabilities Act and the like, but I think it's in pretty good shape, and I think everyone has a mutual interest in ensuring that there is a review and a physician in effect certifies that someone's recovered or is fit for duty, and if not, what aspects of a job might not be appropriate, which could also be specified there. So I think it's good from everyone's perspective.
At what point does this necessity for this type of form kick in? Somebody's out for a week because they're sick. That's different if they're out of work for a few days because they're sick versus like a workers' comp or a
Where somebody goes out based on an opinion of a physician.
Okay, so they're not able to return to work because they've gotten some documentation that says they're not able to perform their job, then this clearly kicks in.
Doesn't comp have a form? Because, I mean, I've read a form from comp that's similar to this, but usually it says, you know, it gives the information similar to the top of the form, and it says, you know, can the employee return, you know, without restrictions to his job responsibilities, yes, no, date for return. If he can't return, can he return light duty or with restrictions? If yes, what are those restrictions? Like, there's that, I mean, I thought comp had a form that pretty much laid it, mapped it out in that sequence.
I'm sure different language. Worker comp providers will have different policies and different forms. The one we're currently using and the one we previously used apparently didn't require anything.
What this also does is it has a section that's filled out to describe the actual job functions, which I think makes it a little bit more thorough from our viewpoint. And we talked about possibly attaching an actual printed list of what the job functions are, but since they could change regularly, it's a bit of a check that the town would say, or the town or the department head would say, these are the functions that this employee is serving, and have the physician take a look at that.
Would there be a section on here that where the employee signs also?
It's really for the physician to authorize the employee to come back to work. Yeah. And that's, again, Don brought up a very good point. What we want the physician to do is say, the employee is ready to come back and perform these functions.
Yeah. Can we... I mean, I think the form is a good idea, but could we table this maybe to the next meeting, and maybe each of us could go back to our respective full-time jobs and see if maybe we have some forms that might add some value to this?
This is my full-time job.
Well, with the exception of the supervisor.
Yes, certainly we could table this.
My full-time job is keeping an eye on Santa, so, you know.
Been bad, and I know it.
He's in the North Pole now, so. Cole, for you.
Sure, Kev, let us know.
Yeah, okay, I'll find. Sure. I mean, I'll go.
Well, we can table this.
Okay.
There's no rush to
I think
this.
It's a good idea.
Okay. I do.
All
right. Just see if they.
I think the ones I remember is the employee fills in the top part, and then gives it to the doctor to complete. But I don't think it's a bad idea having the job head. But I'll see. I'll find some. We have some comp files in the office.
All right, so next, for many years, the town of Patterson has been picking up the garbage at the Field of Wars apartments. This was an apartment complex down on Farm to Market Road that was available to people to rent apartments. In 2015, the complex was purchased by the Watchtower Education Society. They paid last year's taxes on it, but it is now in an exempt class. They have taken it off the tax rolls and are no longer paying garbage, the benefit units for the garbage. They are also using it as kind of an annex to their current facility. And so my opinion, and I have talked about this with Russ, is that they would no longer qualify as a residential complex to be receiving sanitation services from the town. So I just want everybody to be aware that I'm sending them a nice little letter saying thank you for everything, but we are no longer providing sanitation services as of the 1st. And I have had this discussion with them. So they are aware it's coming.
Happy New Year.
Yep. Last on my agenda, we had a situation going back to workers' comp where, unfortunately, our highway foreman was injured, had to take some time off, and Russ felt it was appropriate. He appointed a highway employee down there as acting highway superintendent.
Acting foreman, you mean?
Acting foreman, I'm sorry. Yes, not highway superintendent. We love you, Russ.
Russ came up out of his chair pretty quick there.
Yeah. Highway foreman. Anyway, the issue is that typically when an employee down at highway works out of title for the time that they're working out of title, they're compensated at the higher rate of pay. Acting highway foreman is a little bit of a different animal because not only are they, you know, working out of title for the time that they're actually performing the duties during the day, but they're on call at night. They have to come in on weekends. They perform, you know, they have a much greater obligation when they're acting highway foreman. So the union, CSEA, was looking to have them compensated appropriately. I met with representatives of CSEA. We did work out this agreement, which I think is appropriate and fair both to CSEA and to the town, which allows for additional compensation for the acting foreman. So what I'm looking to do is to get this approved, and then Phil, correct me if I'm wrong, we will put this in the book. So that in the future.
Fine.
All right, I'd like to make a motion. We approve the
MOA.
The amendment to the CSEA agreement to address the acting foreman in the absence of the highway foreman. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
This is, it's worded as long-term absence. This isn't the guy's out for a week on vacation.
It's
catastrophic injury or
yes.
Significant event.
Yes.
Okay.
So we're good.
Good.
All right. I have a couple of other items I'd like to throw on my agenda. One has to do with the ambulance supplies, now that we've purchased an ambulance. And the second one is the EMS administrator. So I'd like to make that, state that in the form of a motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. First up. Is ambulance supplies. Now that we've got an ambulance, we need to stock it. I've gotten two quotes from probably the two leading suppliers within the area. The cost to stock the ambulance, and again, I'm not going to be stocking the ambulance, but I know we need certain supplies to meet the Part 800 requirements for the Department of Health. And we need to stock the ambulance before we can get the inspection, before we can put it back on the road originally. We've solicited, actually the EMS committee has solicited a couple of proposals, one from Medical Warehouse, and the other one from Borderline.
Borderline Boundary,
Boundary. Yes. We're looking to spend about $7,500 to stock the ambulance with medical supplies. Would like to know how you would like to go forward with this, whether you just want me to start making purchases. Trish did not have a problem with this because she said they were individual items. None of them exceeded the threshold for procurement. But it is a lump sum amount that we're looking, and I don't necessarily agree with that assessment.
Well, why don't we have the EMS coordinator do this?
Because, well, the EMS coordinator is going to be looking at these and authorizing the purchase. I'm not going to go buy the material because I wouldn't know one from the other.
So what exactly?
So I'm looking for some guidance on the town board because we're trying to get this up very quickly on how you want to move forward with this, whether you just want to authorize a lump sum amount to be purchased. Or you'll want to wait.
You're still going to get different bids. That's what you're talking.
Well, we've gotten the three bids.
Yeah. So you're looking for a resolution sort of like, or a motion that says town board authorizes the supervisor with regard to ambulance supplies to purchase said supplies not to exceed X.
I believe it was actually the cheapest quote we got was for Boundtree.
Did we get these?
Boundtree. I don't know if you've gotten them. I thought you had, but okay. Which I believe was $7,600. Honestly, what I think we're going to do, though, is go shopping between the two. So what I'm looking for, what I'd like to see you do is authorize us to go ahead with the purchase for the supplies for the ambulance in an amount not to exceed $7,600. And then when we get the EMS administrator on board, then they will be making the purchases.
That's fine.
again, timing is what I'm most concerned with about all this.
Yeah. All right, so.
I would just concur with that, Rich, because as I had, when we met the last time, Putnam Lake has given us a whole bunch of supplies. They had a brand, they knew that we're going to, so we're going to kind of Chinese menu shop it versus right. need everything. We know, we already have backboards, brand new, still wrapped up, things like that. So we'll go through the list with the administrator, with the committee, and then we'll decide what we need to make the Part 800 so that we can get inspected. So I think that, that makes more sense versus picking one of the three vendors. Just get the dollar amount available to whoever's going to make the purchase, and we'll make a list of what we need and what we don't need, and we can move forward from there.
We just spent $146,000 on an ambulance. What's $7,500?
Yeah, right. It's $7,500.
And it's useless if there's nothing in it.
Yeah, I mean, the ambulance is just going to park, be parked outside, sit there.
All right. So I'm fine with that.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
All right.
Do you need a motion?
Motion to approve the purchase of medical supplies to stock the ambulance and an amount not to exceed
$7,600.
$8,000. Fine.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Moving forward. We need an EMS administrator because I've just about reached the limit about where I can take this, not having the background in EMS.
We have, what, a dozen
so
resumes?
We have at least. A lot. Two more came in today.
When was the deadline? Or when is
today.
It? Today. So
today.
The so two we got today were in.
Correct.
Okay.
About
15 or 16 or so. Least.
What I would like to recommend to the board is that we, and let me share this with you, is that we invite, actually I was going to suggest three people, but based on one of the resumes we received today, I'd like to invite four people in. Based on their qualifications and proximity, I'd like to invite Zachary Goldfeder, Elizabeth Bodnar, and Denise Montana, and also Robert Kearns in to be interviewed.
Would there be any benefit for before just, I mean, I've looked at the resumes and, you know, I haven't scrutinized them, but would there be some benefit for the board meeting and work session for an hour and collectively reviewing the resumes and then we can agree or disagree with those five?
Would you prefer that?
Personally, I would, but what does that mean? Yeah. I mean, I'm trying to make other work for everyone else, but I couldn't tell you that that was an informed decision.
Give me those again.
I think that's fair.
Okay. What's the date that we're looking to try to do the interviews? We're trying to do this sometime next week?
I would like to try to have the interviews next week. Yeah. They mentioned at the last town board meeting, I'd like to have a special meeting next week to do the interviews. And I'd also like to decide how we're going to move forward with doing the hire.
What shift are you doing now, Pete? Are you nights? Or like when do you?
I'm off tomorrow, Friday, then I go to 4 to 12s. 5 days.
I think Kev is right. We should meet as a board one night next week and talk about, we should review all the resumes. Each of us, and then come back, meet for an hour,
talk to
and everybody says, you know, here's my top three, and see where we stand.
Okay, when do you want to do that?
Yeah. Monday night, Tuesday
second night.
Monday?
I'm not available Monday.
Well, we can meet Monday, and you can email us your top five, and
yeah.
Let's do that. We're going to have to do it with who we can, and then... More important that you're here for the interviews.
Yeah.
You know.
It's fine.
Yeah. Monday, what time?
5:30, 6 o'clock.
5:30.
Whatever time, Kevin.
Yeah.
I don't know what.
I don't think I have any meetings on Monday. Whatever you all. Do six? What time do you get out?
5. So I could be here by quarter after.
Say 5:30?
Sure.
All right.
5:30 it is.
Okay.
Antoinette, do you have all of the resumes together in one, like in one Adobe?
They're downstairs in your office.
Oh, they are?
Yeah.
All of them?
Okay. They all.
Well,
yeah,
okay.
Except for two that you got today.
No, I was just thinking.
Do you want copies?
Well, not even copies, just like an Adobe scan. Like, could you scan them and send one Adobe attachment?
I already have that set up, so
all right, so then send it. Just send us the Adobe attachment. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay.
What's next one?
Great. 19.
Special meeting then, right? You said
special meeting, Monday night, 5:30.
Anticipate discussing this in executive session.
Correct.
So you move to go in.
Okay. Okay, any other town board member have any other business?
Executive session, sorry.
If you would like to talk about it in executive session?
I thought you were going to.
I was on the fence about whether to do it tonight or next meeting.
Next meeting's fine.
You had one other thing that you had sitting on your top here, which was the building permit request for waiver of fees.
That's true, but Bob never came back to us with a recommendation, so we'll move that one up.
Got it.
So I'm fine with doing that the next meeting, that's fine.
Yeah, and I did talk to Don about it before this meeting, so he is aware. So, anybody? Public recognition? Anybody from the public have anything they'd like to approach the board with?
Hi, it's Pat Plugger again. A bit of good news, and I don't know if it's been announced since the last, no, at the last board meeting, it wouldn't have because it didn't happen yet. Putnam Lake is proud to be the host of the Patterson Bagel Company on Haviland Drive. So, Kevin, you do not have to drive to Brewster. This is the Daily Bagel, folks.
How did you know that I was
Craving
bagels?
Because you and I used to talk about it a lot, yes. So, Economic Development Corporation, or whatever fate brought it, tried it, really good.
They're on Haviland?
Haviland Drive, right next, where all of our commercial buildings are on Haviland, not Fairfield.
What was it called last? JJ's Lakeside?
The Chinese place.
Okay. Yeah, right down the hill from his house. Yes. Yeah. So we're just proud to say we do have a new business in our part of town, so please come and visit us.
I'll go get bagels on Saturday, Pat.
Thank you.
Thanks, Pat.
Anyone else? Going once? Bill?
Phil Calvo, the Highway Department. Usually nobody gets to see me unless I'm up here causing a problem for somebody, but it's been almost a year now. It's hard to believe it flew by this fast. Richie was just coming into office. We were still in the middle of a tumultuous contract. And if anybody had asked me a year later where we'd probably be, I'd say we'd probably still be fighting with Rich and the town board over contracts and sanitation and stuff. And as easy as it is for me to be up here and be the instigator and, you know, fight and push buttons, it's a little bit odd for me to stand up here and be appreciative. First off, Richie stood to his word, committed to sanitation, kept those jobs, and not only are those guys appreciative, I'm very appreciative for that. I thank him for that. He's committed funds to it, and we're seeing the place turn around and doing a lot more than they used to do. I want to thank town board whole for sticking with us and seeing the contract through. And there was 3 points that we were going to go to fact finding. That would have just kicked it down the road for 8 months to a year for sure. And everybody, you know, stayed with us and stayed the course and sat down, even when it wasn't easy, till we got it hammered out, which was much better than going to fact finding. To that note, you know, I had conversations with Kevin Burns on many occasions, worked with Sean and Pete on sanitation, spoke with Rich a lot of times, sometimes at odds, sometimes good. Me and Charlie spoke when Charlie first got here over equipment for highway. But, Kevin, you know, kept on top of me. And I know everybody else had conversations on the side, too, about Russ taking over sanitation and taking on the added responsibility. And I just want to say thank you for sticking with that, because it worked out well, although, you know, it may be more of a headache for Russ, but, you know, he's stuck with it and saw those guys through constantly between him and Margo. They're looking for upgrades and updates and more grant money that they can possibly squeeze wherever they can squeeze to make that a more viable situation over there. So I guess what I didn't see coming, and it's kind of hard on me because I'm used to being here being angry about something, is I'm very appreciative for this whole last year, getting through what we got through and hoping for a much better 2017. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bill, and you know, the gentlemen down at Highway who maintain our roads, they do an absolutely phenomenal job. So we appreciate that. And you know, I'm glad that we could learn to come to a mutual respect and work through our issues and get to where we are. And I think we're in a really good place now. So.
Yeah, I think we're heading in a better direction.
I agree with
I
you.
I appreciate it.
2017 should be great.
Yep. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thanks. Stay safe.
Anyone else? Motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you all for coming.